Hello everybody, hello from Croatia, from University of Zagreb, where I'll be presenting the work that a colleague Denis Salopek and I, Marko Zec, were doing recently. And the talk is about fast packet filtering in user space. So here's a brief intro. What's our motivation? As we all know, the networks are getting faster, and 10 gigabit Ethernet is no more a thing these days. So we just bought a quad port Intel card for a bunch of euros, and this has really been moving away from exotic stuff to the commodity. And of course the question is, how are we prepared to deal with huge amounts of packets that come along with progressing to bigger speeds, which is inevitable. So I actually do not know the answer of the questions that are posted here. I think the bridge may be moving 1 million packets per second or so, maybe less, maybe more. There are people who are doing great work to improve that. But all in all, if I'm not mistaken, this may be moving from 1 million packets per second range to maybe 4, 5, 6. And 10 gigabit Ethernet line rate is, of course, 15 million packets per second. 40G, which is, well, these days getting pretty common in data centers, is 60 million packets per second. So, what can we do? We in FreeBSD for almost a decade now have a neat system for directly mapping packets to user space application, which was developed by Professor Rizzo, and this actually working quite well, and our work is based on top of NetMap to be short. But if we look at the available tools, This one I didn't try myself, but a quote is that the IPFW, which was ported from the kernel to user space, could achieve 6.5 million packets, maybe it would be more today. The question is, of course, can we do better? And, how are other folks dealing with that challenge? So, here's a view from the Linux land, dear friends. They have been completely crazy about the thing which is called XDP. I think it stands for Expedited Data Path. And this is combined with something which is called Enhanced BPF, which of course stands for Berkeley Packet Filter. So the idea is to grab the packets before, just on top of the drivers, before they get encapsulated in complex data structures. I think they have a little bit simpler structures than we have in FreeBSD. But anyhow, they are complex enough, and you get the idea. The goal is to filter anything that you really need to filter at high rates before getting into any complex data paths. So for this to work, they have adopted the BPF doctrine, extended virtual machine from a simple accumulator-based one to a more RIST-like virtual machine, but they have tons of strict rules which they have been imposing, because their goal is that essentially, not anyone, but that they can be pretty safe that whatever one writes as a BPF program won't crash the kernel, which is quite an ambitious goal, but well, as already said, it comes with a string of constraints. This has been used for many applications, but of course, the one that we are interested here today is packet filtering. And from the rumors that we've been hearing, this is mostly used in Cloudflare, Facebook, Google for scrubbing volumetric or flooding denial of service attacks as they enter the end hosts. So not for forwarding packets, but to protect the end hosts when the denial of service attacks hit them. All right, so what's our idea? As already said, we have NetMap, which is quite efficient, very nice, has a nice interface, maps nicely machine structures of network cards, the hardware queues, which may exist in multiple instances per interface, directly to user space. Another concept which is called DPDK, which is being pushed by Intel. It does essentially the same thing, maybe a little bit better optimized and with broader set of libraries, but the foundation of the concept is the same. So one advantage of using NetMap is that we can develop in user space. We don't have to crash the kernel, wait for a machine to reboot all the time. And what's especially nice is that porting NetMap applications from FreeBSD to Linux is, well, just straightforward. So we've covered that. What about the safety checkers which BPF needs for securing unsecure codes when it enters the kernel? Well, we don't need it, obviously. So we have much broader freedom to do whatever we want. And the idea is that we write some filtering rules and directly translate them to C code on the fly as we want to apply new filtering rule sets. And then we offload all the heavy lifting optimization work to the compilers. So, well, of course, you have to be prepared and do not send too much craft to the compiler so that it could actually do something useful. But things, for example, like declaring lookup functions as pure really works nicely. So if we want to have table lookups in multiple rules, and one rule has already done a lookup query, then it will be automatically cached by the compiler for the next rule, which needs the result to reuse again. And so once the compiler has produced the object code, it will be dynamically loaded in a running application, and well, then we can start filtering our packets. And this whole concept has emerged from, of course, from an academic experimental project. One of our major goals was studying how fast can longest prefix matching be done and whether it can be sufficiently fast to support scrubbing denial of service attacks with fine grain whitelists or blacklists, depending what kind of attack and what kind of environment you are interested in. All right, what's my next slide? Okay, so here's the diagram how the internal working of RFPF is structured. So we fire a bunch of threads which operate in a completely lockless fashion and which transfer packets from two interface bundles. We declare one bundle to be our upstream bundle, the other to be the downstream. So this is just like an inline device which we plug between two Ethernet endpoints, and it filters packets. It doesn't do any routing, it doesn't do any TTL modifications, anything. It just looks at the packets and decides whether it has to reject them, pass them, or optionally, what's not shown on this picture, we can have a third set of interfaces to where we can send samples of the traffic, which can be quite useful in times of large-scale attacks, to have, say, 1% of the traffic sent to another machine for more detailed analysis. So again, the data path is completely lockless. So one question that I encountered was, why interface bundles? Well, that was a request that came directly from an ISP. So they are obviously keen on using bundles of 10 gigabit Ethernet links, and I have no idea what is the current terminology. It was, I don't know, link aggregation the last time I looked, but that's the idea. So in one bundle we can have multiple interfaces, and each interface will support multiple queues, which is configured outside of the application at boot time. And typically what we found out is that one or two queues per 10 gigabit interface may be a sweet spot. For faster interfaces, which we don't have, it may be a good idea to have more queues. But by default, I think the operating system tries to disperse all the incoming traffic to all the cores, which may or may not be a good idea with this application. And it really depends on the environment, the type of traffic, what's the optimal configuration. So, and on the bottom of the diagram, we have the supporting functions. We have a command line interface, which initiates parsing of the configuration, compilation, and then when all the new data structures and the new filtering routines are ready, it just sends the pointers to the working threads, which locklessly and asynchronously switch to the new program, and that's it. You have a new configuration up and running. We also have a statistic aggregated thread, which asynchronously fetches and periodically fetches statistics from the worker threads, again without any locking, and it does this in a relatively accurate way, and what this provides are 30-second and 60-second running averages of the packet flow intensity and bandwidth. All right. Next slide. Okay, so here on the left you can see how a testbed looks like. So it's just a plain AMD Ryzen machine with two quad port Intel NICs. Well, so we have the possibility to send, receive 880 gigabits of traffic in total. So the cards are plugged into PCI 3.0 slots with 8 lanes each, which are directly routed to the CPU. And well, that's it about the test environment. The diagram shows how 0-4 rule forwarding or packet dropping throughput scales compared to the XDP. And it doesn't look bad for us at all. Actually, we are getting a lot of complaints from reviewers that why is XDP so slow. There are a lot of reasons. I could talk, well, maybe more in the questions and answers session, but the forwarding part is quite interested. So XDP actually has to execute two separate programs, one on the inbound interface and one on the outbound interface, if one wants to forward packets between them. And what happens is in between is that the current architecture is that packets have to be queued somewhere. I don't know exactly where, but there is an internal queue. Internal intermediate queue. So when a packets come in, one eBPF program decides whether it wants to drop a packet, pass it to the network stack, or forward it directly to another interface. And if it decides to forward, it has actually to queue it into a queue, and then another program has to dequeue it and then put it into the outgoing queue of the other interface, and we don't have to do that. So our data pet processes packets to completion. So actually, I'm lost now. We are processing packets to completion, and we are actually not processing packets one by one, but rather a whole ring at a time. So when we compile a shared object, which we then dynamically link as a forwarding function, it actually is a loop which iterates over inbound queues and then either drops or forwards the packets to the other side. While XDP programs are called on a packet basis. So, there are other overheads, but I think that those are the most significant one. So, all right, so we can scale more or less to the boundary of our PCI bus, and it's cool. All right, so let's see how do we look compared to XDP when we actually want to do some filtering. So here we have a test where we are subjecting traffic to a variable number of rules which have to be parsed sequentially. Rules are really stupid. They are checking for, to be honest, I don't know anymore, source address, protocol, something like this, no, usual stuff. And the rules and the test traffic is set up in such a way that all the rules have to be parsed, and then the packet is finally forwarded. But when a rule is hit, then a counter has to be updated, which is more expensive with XDP, which may further explain why we are so better. So they decided to play it safe. This is a totally different approach. We have better freedom, and our counters are PCPU based, and there is absolutely no need to lock them at all. And these CPUs and threads run at full speed and don't care about the other threads. This is the case when the packets are forwarded, and we are doing even better when we don't have to forward the packets. Then we obviously have more CPU cycles at our disposal, so linearly passing usual style firewall rules is quite fast. Okay, and finally, here's an working example of an RFPF configuration file. So a configuration file is a plain text ASCII. It permits including subfiles, which usually will be useful for defining big tables. So here we have predefined three LPM longest prefix matching tables with GeoIP mappings, so mapping an IP subnet to a country with 300,000 networks or something like that, and quite a lot of specific end hosts. So this is a list of /32 entries, which the whitelist is something that we created ourselves by tracking our traffic during a certain time frame. And blacklist was fetched from a popular aggregator. So we have the possibility to do some defines, and then we define two completely separate rule sets. One goes in upstream direction, the other goes in the opposite one. So the idea is that in cases where high packet rate filtering is required, it may be the rule sets may be quite asymmetric. So that's why we decided to compose the whole set that way. And as you can see on the bottom, we can select on protocols, ports, well, usual stuff, loosely modeled against IPFW. But well, we didn't want to restrict ourselves to any strict compatibility. It's just something we came up with. Maybe useful. Someone will like it. Some will not. Let me go a little bit back to the middle section of the screen. So the idea here is to typical scenario how we are contemplating flood type attacks could be not combated but a little bit dampened or scrubbed. So if we know that certain hosts are okay, we can whitelist them, and that's it. If we know about the bad guys, we are done. They go to dev null. And then, for the things that we do not know, we may want to do, I don't know, maybe country lookup, or we can also do lookups by AS number, or we can even do lookup by city. This is quite heavy stuff, and not all longest prefix matching schemes are up to that task. The line which begins with a sample is obviously with certain probability. If a rule matches, then a packet will be sent to a snooping interface group, and our default action is to accept. That means to forward the packet. All right, five more slides. What I have to show is this. Okay, how do we do with table lookups? That was actually our major one. So the test setup that we use to run these benchmarks is loosely modeled against the rule set from the previous slide, but it's constructed in such a way that whatever kind of packets goes in, it will be matched against all the tables. So none of the tables will actually drop, but the packet will be forwarded, but the cycles will be spent on searching the longest prefix matching tables. And here we see the comparison between different flavors of longest prefix matching. The lowest one is our famous BSD Radix 3, which is hopelessly slow. we decided to include it for reference. Poptra is one quite famous lookup scheme from 5 years ago, which apparently doesn't scale that well with this kind of load. Direct 24.8 is a scheme which was designed at Stanford 22 years ago and is very commonly used in Qlik and in particular in DPDK, where it is available as a default longest prefix matching library. And SAIL is another research LPM from China, and the top, of course, those are ours. Those are the best. Those are two derivatives of the DXR scheme that was designed in the University of Zagreb. I think 8 years ago was the original time when we published this. Let's see what happens if we change the... let me go back. So we are bombarding this with a simulated botnet attack, which means the addresses of the source addresses are fixed among a fixed set. So we are simulating an attack where the attackers cannot spoof the source addresses. If the attackers can spoof or could spoof the source addresses, then random traffic would be more appropriate emulation. And in that case, the ordering of the lookup schemes changes a little bit, but again, for this particular kind of work, a newer variation of DXR does quite well. I think we top at somewhere 65 million packets per second, which is more than 40 gigabit line rate. What happens if we change our blacklist? So previously we had a blacklist which encompassed 170 or 80,000 hosts. Now we have one which is quite bigger and includes more than a million. Again, we pulled this blacklist from another popular aggregator. We didn't make it up ourselves. So this is a list of really problematic hosts which someone somehow identified as, well, suspicious at least. So what can be observed here, that few of LPM schemes disappeared. So SAIL and the Stanford scheme have structural problems and cannot accommodate this kind of work at all, because they were optimized for BGP-like LPM datasets, which are dominated with prefixes which are /24 or less specific, and they just hit the wall and that's it, they are gone. So, of course, BSD works as always, reliably, but slowly. We have Poptra, which doesn't really shine, and DXR, which works slower than in the previous example, but, well, data degradation is minimal. And again, with a different type of traffic, with fully random traffic, all the schemes are performing slightly better. So what's the moral of this story? Of course, as an author of DXR, I'm happy to announce that DXR won this contest, but that's not the main point. The main point is really that we now have the tools, whether this is DXR or Poptra or any of other schemes, that people have not thought about earlier, or at least not that we were aware of, as a means of combating flood type attacks. And that's exactly what we wanted to accomplish. All right, concluding remarks. Restricted feature set. So where we did this come from? We wanted to emphasize that we are striving for speed, and to be fast, one have to keep things simple. So no bells and whistles, and especially no any kind of stateful flow tracking, address translation, nothing like that, because it would immensely complicate locking. As well, at least I don't have a clear idea. So it can be done, of course, but the question is whether the price that has to be paid in terms of performance is worth it. We don't have incremental updates. What does that mean? So to parse a new config, which really is huge, it takes just a few seconds. And it's completely feasible if you have enough memory to have multiple pre-processed configurations, including obscenely big whitelists or blacklists, and have them prepared in memory with all the lookup structures pre-built, everything set up and ready to go. And should the need arise, at a flip of a switch, one can instantly apply or switch from one config to another, without any delays. We haven't actually implemented this multiple choice functionality, but what we have is the ability to instantly revert to a previous configuration and then redo, which is exactly the functionality which, well, someone just has to add the multiple config capability to the CLI. And the final remark, XDP. So as we were forced to do a comparison against XDP, Denis Elopek, colleague of mine, took the challenge, and he wrote entire XDP backend for our parser. So what we can do in user space, we can more or less do in Linux kernel with XDP, but you already saw, well, what you can expect out of it, and well, maybe someone will want to try just that, and it's there in the source code. And this definitely wasn't a trivial piece of work. So to conclude, our code is still pretty rough and experimental. It has definitely tons of security holes. If you're using this stuff, you probably know what you are doing, but there's certainly a lot of room for cleanups. We have been running this actually in production for over a year at our department at the University of Zagreb, so all this traffic that I've been sending and receiving went through RFPF. It didn't crash, but we didn't try to do anything fancy. We just wanted to do whether it would crash, whether it would start spitting memory leaks, and it seems pretty stable in a modest environment. I can also tell you that it runs elsewhere, but I cannot tell you where exactly, but it's outside the academic environment. So that's more or less it. We are quite unprepared to move this to GitHub. I don't have the I'm too old for getting complaints of, oh, why is this? I have to check for a null pointer. When we iron this out, well, we'll definitely push it there. But until that time, you have the URL here, and you can check out the daily snapshot if you wish. Try to compile it on BSD or on Linux, maybe, if you want, if you prefer that. Oh, here's one. Actually, all my figures are fake. And why are they fake? They are fake because we run all these benchmarks on Linux. And why did we do that? Because Linux is faster with network. Why is that? We have no idea. So with Linux, we could hit full 84 million packets per second, dropping rate 74 forwarding. With FreeBSD, I don't know from the top of my head, but I think we were stuck somewhere around 60, 65, definitely below 70. So this is something that we have to look at, or it's a pity that Linux folks have an upper hand here, but I don't think this is something which cannot be fixed. But another problem that we encounter is we could run this, and we run this, and we have tested this, and where we have this in production, it's running on FreeBSD 11.3, 11.4. On 12, most of the drivers have been converted to iFlib, whether this is the cause or not, but we cannot get it to run stably. And so the same code runs perfectly on Linux, runs rock solid on FreeBSD 11.3.2.3.4. But on FreeBSD 12, well, we have just given up. We have to look, go back and look what's really going on. Okay, and that wraps it up for today, and I'll be happy to answer the questions a little bit later. All right, take care. Bye, everybody. I don't see the question.
Okay. The question that I see is, does it make any sense to cache recent decisions? That was on stream one. BSDCan stream one.
I don't see it on the GitHub. Okay, it's not on the GitHub. I assume it's targeting on the longest prefix matching strategy, and I would say that the strategy would be exactly the opposite. So if any lookup scheme that relies on caching is more likely to be destroyed if it gets bounded by denial of service attacks of flooding type. And we are already, with the system that we have, we are already very close to line rates. Actually, we can do 40 gigabit Ethernet line rate with just 6 to 8 cores without any kind of caching. So I hope that this answers that question. Do we have another one? I don't see any questions. I don't see.
I think that was the only question.
All right. So thank you, Dan. Hope you all enjoy it. And thanks for having me here.
Okay. Thank you, Marko.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Goodbye.